Well, good morning. Praise the Lord. God is good. Shalom. Wonderful Savior. We thank you for another time. Thank you for this opportunity that we have to bring you the precious word of God on this day that we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. Every day ought to be a celebration in remembrance of who we honor and who we praise. God has been so very good, I believe, to all of us. And we continually reap God's blessings every single day. As we close out this series regarding tapping into God's blessings, I pray that those of you that have been up under this teaching have learned how to get into those special blessings that God has prepared for those that trust Him. I've said it before, there are everyday blessings that God has for the world. Everybody has those. You wake up in the morning, that's a blessing. You take your next breath, that is a blessing. That's communal. But there are special blessings that God has in store for His children that go beyond what the rest of the world receives. And He wants you to learn how to tap into those blessings by doing the things that He wants you to do. So we talked about, last week we talked about giving. We've talked about getting out of the boat, going beyond. We've even talked about how you are to bless Him, praise Him, honor Him. Give Him what He is requiring. God wants us all to do the things that will show how good He is to us. We are to bless Him. But starting on this one here, because it is the time that we are blessing Him, the best is yet to come.
Amen.
God's best is yet to come. God intends for His children to be abundantly blessed. We must trust His divine word to be obedient to follow those directions. See, God gives you something and He's expecting you to be obedient, to follow what He tells you to do, whether you understand it or not. A lot of times God will tell us things and they seem to be so out of the norm for us. But guarantee God knows exactly what He's doing. He knows exactly the word that He wants and He has for you. And He expects you to be obedient to follow all of those directions. Jesus Christ gave His life so that you and I could live free and have everlasting life. See, Christ's sacrifice on the cross and His resurrection from the grave has given the promise of the kingdom to everyone who believes in Him. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I don't hear too many amens on that.
Amen. Amen.
So you got to understand that God is promising the kingdom to all who believe and all who follow Him. See, we're living beneath our privilege when we don't get the things that God has in store for us as His children. See, the rest of the world has just what I call generalities, but God's got specialities for each and every one of you who believe in Him.
Amen.
He has assured eternal life. See, it's hard for us to fathom that because we live in time. Everything we do has to do with time. We know that there are 60 seconds to a minute. We know there's 60 minutes to an hour, 24 hours to a day. We know every day there are 7 days to a week, 52 weeks to a year. And I ain't telling you how old I am, so you'd be able to try to calculate that out. How long I've been around. But I've been around. And see, we all deal in time, but God has no time, so the fathom eternity, sometimes it's hard for us to even put that in our minds, but He's granted that. He has told that. We are assured eternal life if we have faith and believe in Him. However, we also are ensured that the life that we live here and now, can and will be better than when we understand that we have to submit to His will. John 3:16-17.
For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved.
See, the world through Christ might be saved. It's one of the things that I love about this scripture. We all have seen or been to a ball game, and you've seen somebody holding up the sign, John 3:16. Many of us can quote it, possibly without even thinking about God loving the world. But I'm especially partial to verse 17, because we're condemning too many people by what we think people ought to be and how we expect people to act. When they don't act the way we think they ought to, or they don't say the things we think they ought to say, first thing we want to say is, well, you know, they ain't saved anyway. He did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world. The world through Him must be saved. That's why we're celebrating today. Everybody's going to die, but one got up.
Amen. Amen.
He got up because you and I needed salvation. You and I needed to know that there was a God who was able to see us through everything that we need here, now, not wait until we get to heaven, here and now. God wants you to have that. We have to submit to His will and follow His directions. John 10:10b says, I have come that you might have life and that you may have it, what?
More abundantly.
See, we're always trying to wait till we get to heaven, to the great by and by. God's trying to tell you, I got something for you right here, right now, here on this earth. I want you to live abundantly now. You got to learn them. When you tap into those blessings of Him, He's got something special. It's got your name on it. Don't have nobody else's name on it. It's all for you. But you got to be obedient. Got to follow His directions. God promised overflowing and abundant blessings if we diligently obey the voice of the Lord and carefully observe His commandments. God is speaking all the time. We just have to make sure that we listen with a heart that's been tuned to God's frequency. See, that's the problem. See, God's always talking. God is always talking. He is always giving His word. He is always trying to get us to listen. The problem is we aren't tuned to His frequency. See, they don't have that too much anymore, the radios. We got Pandora and many other little apps that would give you music. But back in my time, I'm telling you how old I am again. We used to have to turn that knob. You got a lot of static. But then when you start hearing it come in, you turn it a little bit more till you get that crystal clear sound. And you take your hand off, because you know once you got it set, you're going to hear everything. You're going to hear the melody. You're going to hear the harmony. You're going to hear all the brass and the bass. And you're going to hear the voices singing. You got great frequency. God is talking all the time. You got to turn your frequency to God. And when He talks, you can hear Him. Deuteronomy 28:1-14.
If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully keep all His commands that I am giving you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the world. You will experience all these blessings if you obey the Lord your God. Your towns and your fields will be blessed. Your children and your crops will be blessed. The offspring of your herds and your flocks will be blessed. Your fruit baskets and your breadboards will be blessed. Wherever you go and whatever you do will be blessed. The Lord will conquer your enemies when they attack you. They will attack you from one direction, but they will scatter from you in seven. The Lord will guarantee a blessing on everything you do and will fill your storehouses with grain. The Lord, your God, will bless you in the land he is giving you. If you obey the commands of the Lord your God and walk in his ways, the Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he swore he would do. Then all the nations of the world will see that you are a people claimed by the Lord, and that they will stand in awe of you. The Lord will give you prosperity in the land that he swore to your ancestors to give you, blessing you with many children and numerous livestock and abundant crops. The Lord will send rain at the proper time from his rich treasury in heavens and will bless all the work you do. You will lend to many nations, but you will never need to borrow from them. If you listen to these commands of the Lord your God that I am giving you today, and you carefully obey them, the Lord will make you the head and not the tail. And you will always be on top and never at the bottom. You must not turn away from any of the commands I am giving you today, nor follow after other gods and worship them.
Did you hear that?
Amen.
How many times did it say, bless you? So many times. God wants you to know he wants to bless you. He wants to make you set above all the other nations of the earth, or all the other people who don't claim God as their king.
Amen.
Amen.
He wants to show you off. I don't know about you, but I can remember a few times when my children did some things or brought home a good paper or whatever. I couldn't wait to show it to somebody. Yeah, check this out.
Yep.
Yeah, this is my child. Yeah, this come from me. Look what I did. See, that's what God wants to do for you. He wants to show you off. He wants to illuminate you. He wants the world to see that as his child, he blesses you because you're obedient. He blesses you because you follow his directions. He blesses you because you bless him right back. God is a good God. The word of God gives direction. And he wants you to be successful, and he wants you to be prosperous. We lose that because we think we need to be like everybody else. Can we all just get along? No, you are not supposed to be like everybody else. You're supposed to be the head. He said you're going to make you the head and not the tail. You're going to be the lender and not the borrower. See, when you're the borrower, that means you're up under somebody else's thumb. But when you're the lender, you stand up tall. People have to come to you. That's a good feeling. When you are able to bless others and show the God's great mercy. Just like baking a cake, when we follow the directions, the results are flawless and are enjoyed by all who are in our sphere of influence.
That's a good looking cake.
That's a good looking cake. And I know it's sunny. I know y'all can't wait to get out of here and go get you some meat.
Good looking cake.
But it's flawless because the directions were followed. And that's why it looks like this. What do you think God wants to do with you when you follow his directions? He'll make you look just as good as that cake. He'll make you just as flawless as anything else. And then all of those who are in your sphere, here's the thing about being prosperous and being successful. When people are around you and you're prosperous and you're successful, it's going to rub off on them. They have a way of becoming more successful because you're successful. They have a way of learning more about prosperity because you have been made prosperous. My wife learned how to make some cakes. My wife hasn't made a cake in a long time, but my wife learned a lot, I believe, from her sister, because her sister makes some cakes, make you want to...
She cooks like an old lady.
Shout hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jesus.
They
real good. Yeah, man. In fact, I know she got one coming for me real soon. But because of the way that she has been prosperous and the way she has been, it's rubbed off. To where my wife makes the cake now, make you go, oh, thank you, Lord. This is what God wants for his children. Now, we spread this around the world. See, when Jesus gave his life, he didn't do it just so that you could come to church on a Sunday and say, thank you, Lord. He put seeds in you because he expects a harvest from you so that you can spread this message around the world. People still talking about Jesus. I don't care what other religion's popping up. I don't care what other religions that's been going on for a long time. People still talking about Jesus. His name will go on forever. Because of who and what he is and what he's done for all of us. Joshua 1 and 8.
This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success.
See, when you follow God's word, he's guaranteed you prosperity. And here's the thing about prosperity. Everybody thinks it's all about money. Prosperity is more than money. God's favor is better than money.
Amen.
When you have the ability to reach and touch someone because of what God has placed in you, you become a more prosperous person. I know people that's got lots of money and they're the most sorrowful, most miserable people in the world. And they got plenty of money. And that, you know, the money don't solve everything. But I also know people that don't have two pennies to rub together. And you want to be around those people because they're some of the most warm, loving, caring, giving people. That's what makes them prosperous. It's what's on the inside, but not what's on the outside. It's what they can give, not what they can get. God wants us to live that type of life. And when we follow his law, when we follow his word, when he gives us the direction that we're obedient to do, and we meditate all the time, we put his word before us, we don't forget what he's told us. He's given us a promise that we live this way. We, as children of the king, we got to live righteously. Our lives are to be an example of holiness and godliness. See, now, living life this way, we're guaranteed a bountiful and prosperous harvest. You should never have to want. David said it best. I watched him this week. I've been trying to really fill my mind with so much God. Because I'm like, Lord, I'm going to really want to celebrate. Really want to celebrate this year. The resurrection of my Lord. So I was watching videos about David. And it was just so amazing. When it came to what we call the 23rd Psalms, the first things that came out of his mouth was, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want."
Amen.
See, when God is your shepherd, when he leads and guides you in the way you're supposed to go, you shouldn't want for anything. Your needs should already be met before. He already says, "I know what you have need of before you even ask." He knows what is already on store for you before you even ask. He already knows what is to become of you. One of my favorite scriptures is Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the thoughts I think towards you, saith the Lord. They are thoughts of good and not of evil. Thoughts to give you a hope and thoughts to give you a future." God's got your future already planned. He wants the best for you. Because the best is yet to come. He's got things ready for you you can't even imagine. And you yield yourself to him, he's given you a promise.
Amen.
Psalms 1:1-3.
"Happy is the man who does not walk in the way of sinful men, tell them to, or stand in the path of sinners, or sit with those who laugh at the truth. But he finds joy in the law of the Lord and thinks about his law day and night. This man is like a tree planted by the rivers of water, which gives its fruit at the right time, and its leaf never dries up. Whatever he does will work out well for him.
Whatever he does is going to work out well. I like that part. He'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, which gives its fruit at the right time, and its leaves never dry up. That means God's prosperity is continually flowing. It's continually feeding you, continually giving you what you want. We go fishing a lot. One thing I love about going fishing is a lot of times when you're in the water or you're on the bank, those trees that are closest to the water are the strongest trees that there are around, because they have a continual feeding and nourishment. That's what he's trying to tell you. When you obey his word and you steady on his law, you're just like that tree that's constantly being nurtured and fed. Whatever God has for you, you are surely going to get it. The mystery of it all is that Christ in us is the hope of God's glory. Allowing God access and rule over our lives gives the assurance that we have peace and security from him. Now, it doesn't mean that we will not have problems and tests and trials, and we won't go through anything, that our lives are going to be so full and so happy and we can skip along, not a care in the world. That's not what he's trying to tell you. What he is trying to tell you is that you are now part of God's family, and God takes care of his children. He doesn't see that they go wandering and be lost and have needs that they are never met. Colossians 1:27 says, to them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, which is the hope of glory. Amen. See, Christ wants to live in you. That's the hope that we have of the glories that God has in store for each and every one of us. But I love this, Ephesians 3:14-20. Paul says, when I think of the wisdom and scope of his plan, I fall down on my knees and pray to the Father of all the great family of God. Some of them are already in heaven, some down here on earth. That out of his glorious, unlimited resources, he will give you the mighty inner strengthening of his Holy Spirit. And I pray that Christ will be more and more at home in your hearts. Amen. Living within you as you trust in him. May your roots grow deep down into the soil of God's marvelous love. May you be able to feel and understand, as all God's children should, how long, how wide, how deep, and how high his love really is. And to experience this love for yourself, though it is so great that you will never see the end of it or fully know or understand it. And so, at last, you will be filled up with God himself. Now glory be to God, who by his mighty power at work within us is able to do far more than we would ever dare to ask or even dream of. Infinitely beyond our highest prayers, desires, thoughts, or hopes. Oh, hallelujah. You see that? This is what God has in store for us. It goes beyond what you can imagine. You can't imagine the glories that God has for you. You can't even begin to think about the height and the depth and the width that God has his love for you. I've heard too many times, God don't love me no more. Jesus, you can't understand that he can never not love you. He can never not love you. He loves you. more than you can imagine. What he has in store for you is more than you can possibly grasp.
Amen.
Jesus Christ gave his life so that we might have a right to that kingdom of God. His sacrifice made it possible. You and I could have that eternal life. We have a place already reserved for us. We got a house made with God's own hands. Made with God's own hands. John 14, 2 to 3. Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Don't you understand? You've already got a place prepared for you. And Jesus is coming back soon.
Yeah.
I believe that. Now, whether it be in a rapture or whether he calls you home singularly, it don't matter. There's a place that is prepared for you.
Thank you, Lord.
God's got something in store for you. The best is yet to come.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 5 and 1 says, "We know that our body, the tent we live in here on earth, it will be destroyed." That's a fact. But when that happens, God will have a house for us. It will not be a house made by human hands. Instead, it will be a home in heaven that will last forever.
Amen.
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 Forever.
Amen.
Forever.
Yeah.
Yes.
Seem like every other day I feel a new roll over. See, young folks haven't really experienced a lot of that yet, but as you get older, you just might.
You have a hitch in your giddy up.
Yeah, you got it. It was called a hitch in the giddy up. That's this body. God's got one that's already made for you. He's preparing it, and it's not made with human hands, made with God's hands.
Yes.
And you'll be able to sing and dance, holler and shout. All day, all night, forever and ever and ever and ever. God's got that prepared for you. Whether here now or in our eternal home, you need to know that the best is yet to come.
Amen.
God's got something special for each and every one of us. He's just waiting on us to just get what he's got. He loves you more than you can imagine. That's why he did not stay in the grave. That's why he got up. Because he knew that you and I would need to have God's best.
Amen.
And you haven't experienced God's best yet, but it's coming. All you got to do is just tap into that goodness of God. Be obedient and follow his directions. Watch God open up the doors, open up the windows of heaven, pour you out so much so you won't have room enough to receive. I pray each and every one of you today reflect on why we celebrate this day. I know we're all going to go, we're going to eat real good, we're going to sit back, we're going to rub our bellies, we're going to enjoy the rest of the day, we're going to be with family, we're going to be with friends, we're going to enjoy, have fun, and enjoy ourselves. And that's exactly what God expects you to do. But he also wants you to have reverence and remember his sacrifice for each and every one of us, so that when we reach that point of being able to get what God has for us, we can just get it. And let God be a blessing to each and every one of us. Amen?
Amen.
And amen. I want to thank you for watching this video. I pray that you were blessed by it, that it encourages you to have a deeper relationship with God, that you continue to fight a good fight of faith and grow strong and courageous in your daily battles with the enemy. I encourage you to subscribe to this page, like us on Facebook, and log on to our website. There you can submit a prayer request and support this ministry through a financial gift. And remember, if each one can reach one, and a reached one can reach one, then a one will have one, and the kingdom will have been advanced one soul at a time. Thank you again, and God bless you.